Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet, God. It's
Can we stand, please? Jesus said, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am. And you know the way to where I'm going." "No, we don't know, Lord," Thomas said. "We have no idea where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus told him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. If you had really known me, you would have known who my Father is. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." Jesus replied, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and yet you still don't know who I am? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. So why are you asking me to show him to you? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words I speak are not my own, but my Father who lives in me does his work through me. Just believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe because of the work you have seen me do. I tell you the truth. Anyone who believes in me will do the same works that I have done, and even greater works, because I am going to be with the Father." Good evening, everyone. Such a delight to see all of you as we are here to celebrate the life of our deceased brother. I say deceased because this is an old worn out garment.
That's right.
But he is alive, and I'll talk a little bit about that a little later. But it's good that you're here to support the family, and we are going to pray at this time. Please join me. Father, thank you that in our busy schedules that we can take time out to stand with loved ones, with friends, with family during this time of loss. We think of Phil and Michelle. We think of Nick and Nicole. We think of Barry and Charmaine and their respective families. And we ask, Lord, that you will comfort their hearts. In times when, Lord, words may seem very insufficient to really express how we feel and what we think about them and what they're going through. But thank you that you have given us your Holy Spirit to comfort us. And I pray, Holy Spirit, that you will comfort their hearts during this time of loss. Yes, times of fond memories, times of laughter, times of celebration, but also times of sorrow to know that for a while that Peter will no longer be with us. But we thank you for your word, and we thank you for all that you are to us. And I ask, Lord, that you will be very close and very real and very near to them. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please remain standing as we will now sing one of Peter's favorite songs, Morning Has Broken. I understand from Michelle that this was a favorite song of his. So please join us as Derek leads us. Morning Has Broken. Reading is taken from Paul's letter, his second letter to the church at Corinth, chapter 5, verses 1 through 10, and it will be read by Reverend Barbara Wilson.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. It's a wonderful occasion in both ways. We're here to celebrate the life of Daddy Dan, to whom everybody who has known him, he's affectionately called. We have come to celebrate his life, and most importantly, to celebrate his home going. His home going. I'm going to read from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and I'm reading from verse 1. I'm not going to tell you where I'm reading to end because you will say it's too long. But I'm Corinthians 5. Now, we know that if this earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now it is God who has made us for this very purpose, and has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. We live by faith and not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. I just want to take, just for Daddy Dan, really. It's for Daddy Dan. Death is not the end for all of us in here who know the Lord. Daddy Dan, to all who were close to him, was brought in here by his family, wheeling him in, walking with him. Why did they have to do that? Because his body just got weak. His body just got tired and worn out. And that will all happen to us too. Every single breath we take is a gift from God. And all of us in here sitting this evening, just us being able to come here is a gift from God. His earthly body just got tired. But Daddy Dan is not in there. You heard Pastor Hynum say it just now. Daddy Dan is not in there. What is in there is just the earthly tent he lived in. But guess the most beautiful thing? He has now traded. He has traded in his earthly tent for a heavenly building. A building not made by human hands, but a building made by the God who loved him and by the God he loved. Built especially for Daddy Dan. And it's also going to be built for us when we too say yes to Jesus. Death is not the end for us. Who know the joy of having a personal relationship with God? will experience and know and have the assurance of that heavenly home. Daddy Dan is at peace, very much at peace. From the day his eyes closed, Daddy Dan went peacefully. Psalm 116:15 tells us, precious, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. I ask you this evening, what is your life? What is your life? As we all learn to submit to God, submit to his way, submit to him who is the way, the truth, and the life, we too will all live like Daddy Dan and my husband and Daddy Dan's wife and your mom. We too will all live again. All of us, or most of us in here this evening, with all the stresses of life and everything that's going on around the world, the floods in Trinidad and everywhere else, all of us, the winds of life, the winds of God, hear me, God will take the winds of adversity in your life, the winds of challenge, the winds of sorrow, the winds of tears, the winds of poverty. God will take those winds, and those same adversity winds will lift you up instead of knocking you down once you know Jesus Christ. Daddy Dan is at peace. Celebrate his life. Rest in peace, Daddy Dan.
Thank you, Reverend Barbara. Our second song is a well-known hymn of the church. It speaks of God's faithfulness, which I'm sure Peter Parker experienced. And if he was here with us this evening, he would be able to sing lustily concerning God's faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord, my Father. Please stand. See you. Scripture reading is taken from Psalm 37, verses 23 through to 26, and will be read by Emma Edwards, who is Peter's granddaughter. Thank you, Emma.
Thank you. Psalm 37, verses 23 to 26. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand. I have been young and now old, yet I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his children begging for bread. He is ever merciful and lends, and his descendants are blessed. Thank you.
Thank you, Emma. Our third hymn, or third song, second hymn, Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Now, I can sing that with great identification as a sinner whom God has saved. So please stand and sing with me about God's amazing grace. Grace is God giving us what we don't deserve. His grace and his love. Please stand and let's sing together. Amazing Grace.
My fears relieved. seated.
What does one say concerning a father, an individual, who has lived a full life and made a sterling contribution to the development of a nation? Well, the three Parker children are going to attempt to give us some insight into this man, Peter Parker. And I'm going to invite Michelle and Nick and also Charmaine to come at this time and to make an attempt at telling us a little bit about this amazing man. Thank you.
Well, hello, everybody. I feel like we're having a party here this afternoon. See a lot of faces that we know. First and foremost, I would like to thank God for the life and service of Peter Parker, a multi-talented man, master mariner, port manager, dairyman, woodworking craftsman extraordinaire, yachtsman, boat and house builder, motorcycle enthusiast, keen fisherman, gardener, keeper of chickens, and just a few of his many attributes. Daddy had a long life, a long and full life. He did so many things. I'm certain that if we asked everyone here this afternoon watching or here, each one would have a story to tell of the Peter Parker they knew and enjoyed friendship with. I cannot do the man justice with mere words, attempting to cover his many achievements, adventures, pastimes, and hobbies. He was first a family man, husband, father, brother, grandfather, and great-grandfather. He was a man of the sea, a master mariner. He spent nearly 12 years at sea with the British Merchant Navy, his brothers John and Robin as well. Over the years, we were regaled with the stories of his adventurous voyages and never tired of hearing of them. He would share them with whoever showed any interest. On his return to the land of his birth with his new and beautiful bride, Cicely Bynoe, around 1956, Stanley Chapman secured Peter almost immediately first to work for DaCosta Shipping in stevedoring, which at the time was carried out by lighters going to and from the ships, bringing their cargo to the warehouses in the Carenage. Very long, arduous hours for Daddy. Following this, Peter was made manager of Port Contractors Limited, giving oversight to the building of the Bridgetown Port. This completely transformed the island's economy by providing berths for all ships and specifically for the export of sugar in bulk, as opposed to hogsheads and bags. Several years later, when government formed the Barbados Port Authority, Peter then became the first general manager of the Barbados Port Authority. A long and successful tenure ensued. During this time, he was also elected the first president of the Caribbean Shipping Association and was highly respected within the industry, both regionally and beyond. Peter's contribution to Barbados through his work at the port will live on in the annals of our history books and in our memories. There are some here and watching today who worked with Peter, and they have already expressed to us the type of person they found Dad to be. Some of their sentiments are an officer and a gentleman, a just and fair man of integrity, a man for all people. He had some very close relationships with all the workers at all levels. Some of the names we can recall who are all long gone: Vaughan, Power, Ashton, Mr. Boston, Mr. Nightingale, to name a few. Some shared his love for carpentry and would help him with his various projects, building boats outside of work. Ozzie Eiffel, another port worker, his wife Ina, aka Eiffie, to all of us, came to assist Mummy when I was born and was like a second mum to the three of us. Nick was her boy. Don't get between them. The Lord truly sent Eiffie to us. Ozzy died relatively young, and Eiffie literally lived with us for a very long time. She went on to spend her last days with her family in Spikestown, where we all visited as often as we could. and had the blessing of celebrating her 100th birthday with her. So Nick is going to carry on into that area. Here are some of my precious memories. Daddy was kind and generous with his time and talents. I recall in 1992 when Hurricane Andrew flattened Miami, Daddy really did not relish flying. Joined with a few others and went to Miami to assist Richard Williams in his outreach to help rebuild homes in their church community. Busy might remember that. Yes. At home here, he also helped with underprivileged children with their further education, giving them lifts to and from school. He installed indoor plumbing for a young mother with 7 children in St. John. Upon hearing of her dire conditions, he took Nick along and they put in the plumbing. Just to mention a few instances of his community-spirited work. He was always fixing and mending things for us and for neighbors. Another one of our dad's attributes I make mention of here, Mummy told me that Dad made some baby clothes for me. He also cut my hair. Charmaine suggested that he might have put a bowl on my head and cut it right round straight like that. Probably did. Anyway, Mummy kept my first locks, and I, thanks to Charm's keeping them safely, I came across them just recently. Daddy used to take me and the Cocker Spaniels, Freckles, Mitzi, Mischief, driving up into country to the Bell Woods for walks and picnics. A splendid copse of mahogany and casuarinas, long since destroyed by the multiple cane fires. But it was one of my first memories with spending time with Dad, and it was a happy place for us all. Another memory of Dad building a big sailboat in our garden at Marine Gardens under a large blue tarp. When he wasn't working at the port, he would be working on this day and night. The help of a big light he had rigged up. The carpenters from the port would come and assist in their spare time. He named that boat Mini Shah, which was after the 3 children, M-I-N-I-C-H-A, all our names put together. So we had lots of wonderful times on that, and he went on to build yet another yacht and to own quite a few more. Daddy loved all our pets. However, he was a bit of a prankster and a tease, so every one of them had a taste of this teasing, and one or two of them had a taste of him. Dad was always making things out of wood. Everything he did had to be done to perfection. He was methodical and kept his wood workshop immaculately. We were all warned. He made countless useful pieces of furniture for our homes. Towel rails, coffee tables, shelving, all the milking stools, cabinets, etc. He shared his vast collection of tools with very few. His brother Robin, who shared his love of carpentry, and only persons he was sure would carry them and return them. Our postman, Andy, was one such person he lent his tools to, knowing he shared his same passion for woodworking. Once I asked him to make me a box to keep the liquor in at our house. It seemed to disappear. I'm not sure what was going on. And a box that could lock, I said to Dad. Well, Dad fashioned a beautiful box made of mahogany, replete with handles and a brass hasp, and placed it on legs. We still use this wonderful piece today, and the hinges are kept busy and well-oiled. It is of special note that Holly, our youngest, was interested in woodwork at school, and her grandfather was pleased to allow her to use his tools in his workshop. His grandson, Lewis, Nick's son, has a passion and a gift for making the most amazing guitars, thus carrying on Daddy's legacy. I must make mention of Dad's and Mum's lifelong friendship with the Marshalls. Tom and Daddy were best friends. Sadly, their friendship was cut short when Tom succumbed to cancer in midlife. However, Tom's lovely bride, Marianne, Nee Hassel, their children, Billy and Gillian, and her husband, Robin, have remained dear and loyal friends to this day. Tom and Dad had many sailing adventures together on the MV Coralita. Tom's parents lived at Clifton Plantation in St. Thomas. Many a Sunday, our parents would take us to visit them. These visits remain forever etched in our memories. Such a beautiful place. The gardens kept immaculately the barns to explore filled with farm animals, and a beautiful wooden two-seater swing for us to hang off of to our heart's content while the grown-ups whiled away the time chatting. As children of a keen and seasoned yachtsman, the keeper of the farthest mooring off the Barbados Yacht Club, we were quite au fait with the practice of taking it in turns rowing in and out on the boat to the boat. After one of our very many sails that Dad took us on, we returned to the mooring and tied up. A long wait ensued while Daddy pottered about the boat. Long after the sun had set, we were still waiting. I decided I would swim ashore, so off I went. As I rounded the bow, Dad caught a glimpse of my shadow in the water and he shouted, "Shark! Shark!" Full well knowing it was me. Well, to him it was a big joke. I took on the character of Beep Beep Roadrunner and treaded the water back to the boat steps, clambering aboard, shivering and out of breath. Such was Daddy's humour. Dad was not to be left out of any of our activities. As teenagers, Nick and Charmaine had scrambler bikes, which they rode on the cart roads. They were not allowed to ride them on the main roads. We all enjoyed horseback riding. Dad learned to ride too. Wasn't too much different to ride in his motorcycle, really, just maybe the horsepowers. He thoroughly enjoyed riding with us and going to all our gymkhanas and shows. Nick had a stint on Gentle Lady, Sharms had her pony Nugget, and I had a beautiful grey Mount Rosette, an ex-racehorse that refused to be boxed, so I had to ride her to every show and back home after. Smelly Melville gave Dad an Arabian mix called Tamaloo, a lively firecracker of a horse. One time Daddy and I were riding along the edge of a gully out at Moonshine, and a cow spooked Tamaloo. She bucked and Dad flew off, landing hard. Tamaloo cantered off home and Dad had to walk gingerly alongside me and Rosette back to Selman's. This did not deter him at all. Dad, I want to thank you for your unswerving love, guidance, firm hand of discipline, an example of what perseverance and hard work can accomplish. We are so blessed to have had parents like you and Mum for such a long part of our lives. I wish to publicly express my thanks to Nick and Nikki, who cared for both Mummy and Daddy in their final chapters with the deepest of unconditional love and selflessness. Thank you, Sharms and Barry, and Tom and Nick, for the many trips home to bring cheer and more love. Thanks too to Dr. Linda Williams, to all the wonderful nurses that we've had over the years, to our very own Diana, AKA Di Di, who nursed both Mummy and then Dad, to their nurses, all of them, Debbie, Charmaine King, and Mary, and Cheryl, and Esther, and all of them, and special mention Barry Nichols, his friend and trainer. Each one of you in a special way was so thankful for your we're thankful to you, and Daddy was specially thankful to you for your tender care. And thanks to all of you, our dearest extended family and friends, neighbors, to everyone who knew and loved and respected our dad. We are so grateful for the wonderful memories we all share that will live on in our hearts. I end now with a quote from Abraham Lincoln. And in the end, it's not the years in your life that count. It's the life in your years. Sail on, Dad. We will meet again.
Thank you very much, Mish. And thank you, everybody, for being here. And for all, anyway, I'm sure at some point, whatever way in which you touched Dad's life or he yours, it was a good thing. I'm glad you all are here. So, I can do my best here. It's kind of long, so I hope you all are looking forward to getting a bit of a story. I had it actually shortened a bit. My dad had a fun early childhood with his two brothers, John and Robin, doing all the three things young men could get up to, whether it be on the family home in the South Coast, or visiting relatives in Strathclyde, or on the West Coast. At an early age, he started to learn skills in making model boats and would eventually turn into making real boats. his brothers, he and his brothers and his friends like Robin Hunt, he called Huntley, of the Merry Men, Charlie. He told me one of the stories they heard this evening was not true. And several others busied themselves fishing, racing, both model and real boats, hunting birds, roasting food, camping, jumping cars, things like that, in pajamas. His childhood was interrupted when he contracted meningitis. I remember him telling me actually that his mom said the doctor had said he might not make it, you know. Anyhow, were it not for his caregivers at the time, he wouldn't have survived. He told me about how one caregiver, this his particular lady that used to take care of him, and the gardener used to take him to the beach and dig a big hole and bury him up to his neck. And that immobilization, I guess, and other massaging and stuff that they did helped him recover from it eventually, but he missed a lot of school. But he caught up because he was a very committed person to his studies and so on. Anyhow, we'll go on to that. His parents sent him and his brothers off to England quite young to finish their schooling. And he never forgot his dad telling him at around age 14, just before boarding a ship to leave from Barbados to the UK, that his schooling and expenses were going to be taken care of until he was 16. And after that, he was going to be on his own. Fairly scary thought for young Peter. He never forgot being told that, and it drove him to succeed even harder in life. For those of you who don't know how training of ship's officers takes place, it's customary for young men and women nowadays as well to be hired as a cadet, whether they're working as a navigation or deck cadet or in the engine room. And they're hired usually by a private shipping company. The training is paid for, and they get small wages, but the training is made up of college and shipboard time. So while at sea, cadets learn and do any and every task, usually the worst ones. And they work in different departments, so they get an all-round experience and understanding of how a ship works. They learn to steer the ship, assist with mooring and anchoring, learning the practical side of navigation, etc. A lot of chipping and painting. Ship owners benefit from the lowest paid employees at this time to get the rough work done on board. Life at sea can vary from days and nights of beautiful seas and skies to fearfully stormy conditions that may even make food preparation impossible for days and nights on end. But the adventure of it for a young man will stay with him forever. And it did for Dad, for sure. Dad perfected his skills in seamanship and applied himself to his studies when his brothers, not bad talking them here, who were cadets with a different company, which I ended up working for too, were more inclined to be distracted by the beautiful ladies in every port. Not that Dad was a stranger to romance, as the many photos with loving notes on the back fixed in his many albums can attest. Some pretty girls. Just friends. Apart from learning everything there is to learn about ships and their handling and operation, the structured hierarchy that exists on board is a perfect training ground for management of time, priorities, self-discipline, coexistence with others, respect for the weather and environment, fuel and water conservation and use. The list is endless. It is a perfect management training exercise. From England and the Mediterranean, India, East Africa, the Red Sea ports, South Africa, the Caribbean, especially Cuba, Dad enjoyed his time at sea on ships. But his studies always came first. Remembering his father's words, he always managed to save money and he developed a keen interest in motorcycles. Bought himself one as soon as he could when he was on leave in the UK. Over the next few years, while in and out of the UK, where his studies and leave time took place, Dad used every opportunity to go riding, whether touring around in the UK and all over the continent when he had more time off. I'm sure you have heard some of those stories. His mum and dad had moved to the UK, and wouldn't you know that his mum happened to be an agile, by the way, happened to be a loving and caring woman who loved to have young Barbadian ladies who were studying in the UK over to stay at a home away from home whenever they had time off from their studies. One of them happened to be the gorgeous Cicely Bino, studying nursing. Well, Sibby decided that she, Cicely, was the one for her middle son, Peter, And after she was nursing her foot, this is Sissy, in bed after a fall while Dad was trying to teach her to ride his motorbike, Sibby primed him up with some gin and sent him in to propose. Another long voyage to South Africa. It was meant to be a short trip, but it was supposed to be there and back, and Sis decided that she wasn't going to be a stay-at-home wife with her husband sailing the seven seas, so back to Barbados it would be. Dad delivered a small cargo ship back across the Atlantic, and his deep-sea days more or less came to an end. Dad was offered a job in shipping. In those days, there was no port, and ships laid out to anchor in Carlisle Bay to await barges or lighters, as they were known, to bring the gangs of stevedores out to offload and reload cargo. Many of these lighters were rowed at one time, and then came more launches to tow and maneuver them in and out of the carenage. Sometimes they would be out alongside ships well into the night to complete the discharge or reload process, and so they didn't come back until the work was done. Michelle was born while Dad was at work on a ship in Carlisle Bay. You would know about that. Many years later, when Dad was in his 80s and I was visiting him, you will laugh at this one too. He lived downstairs with us for 10 years after my mom passed. I thought I was being smart. There was an old black and white photo on the wall of lighter's birth in the inner basin of the carenage. Some of you may have seen it or might even have one at home. I looked at the direction the flag was flying on one of the buildings in the background and said, "Dad, the wind was out of the south that day. Looked like it might have been hurricane season." But Dad proceeded to tell me who those lighters belonged to, who had built them, their tonnages, and what they were built of. So much for my smart observation. Man had a crisp mind. When the Deepwater Harbor was being built, Dad would have had some inputs into various aspects of the port to be, and when it opened in 1961, the year after I was born, he became the first general manager of the Bridgetown Port. I grew up in awe of my dad. I went to work with him from an early age sometimes and accompanied him when I was allowed to as he went about his duties. He told me later in life that his management style was to manage by walking about. And that's what he did in the port on a fairly regular basis. He knew everyone there, and by name, Short Cakey Pants at first. I think eventually they came into darker pants, but Short Cakey Pants and a tucked in white shirt, polished brown shoes, and cakey socks. So Mr. Parker was on the move. I met the mechanics in the workshop, the forklift drivers, the crane operators, shed clerks and managers, security officers, and a station dog named Prince that they used to take around on foot patrol at night, security, you know?
Yeah.
His office was actually where the security offices know.
Yeah.
I met the pilot and tug masters, pilots and tug masters, and went aboard every vessel you can imagine, from submarines, warships, cruise liners, general cargo ships, square riggers, if captain. You know who heard this note. Mm-hmm. He would make me get a QR code. And always looking up at my dad along the way. He spoke respectfully and kindly to every man, asking for their family and responding to queries and giving them advice if they needed it, if he had it to give. Dad loved woodwork, as was pointed out by Mish. He had a small workshop in the garden and used to always be building or making something. He shared his interest with Uncle Robin, who for many years they swapped ideas on what to do and how to do it and tried to outdo each other with who had the best tools. And then, of course, they would rag one another as to who used them the most. You got nice tools, but are you using them? What about that one in the box you haven't used yet? He was extremely particular about his tools, and he never used the tool or let us use a tool without sharpening and oiling it with a rag before putting it back into its correct place in its cupboard. He would then sweep up the sawdust and shavings before the job was complete. He made me toys from wood, a beautiful wooden handgun, and then a rifle. I was so upset when he broke off the barrel in a Cowboys and Indians game match, whatever. Anyhow, model boats he made, and then he made me a prom dinghy as well, which I learned to row and was allowed to take up by myself. He started building his own yacht in the garden, and he and a shipwright from St. Philip. I can remember when they dug a big hole in the garden to cast his lead keel. He had been collecting lumps of lead from whoever would donate, old lead pipes, lumps of lead, whatever he could get. Fire was made, they smelted the lead and poured it bit by bit into this carefully shaped hole, and it became the keel for a 32-foot long sailboat. When I was around 5, Dad took us for a drive in the country, as we often did. But this time to look at a house, or rather a ruin. I can remember being that small and walking into the ruin. Rafters, wooden rafters, rotted and caved in all over the place. You could see the sky. Clearly, it was not much, I don't think it was much roof at all. Dead millipedes and live millipedes, rat droppings, you name it. It was not.
Sweet.
Yeah, it was a ruin. It was a shell. The yard had cuscus grass and rat nests and everything in it that were taller than us children. Dad had a fit borrowing the down payment to get a mortgage. He had to sell that wonderful yacht before it even got launched. Uncle Sonny Edgel bought it, correct? And put the engine in and launched it. He sailed it and fished it for many years until it went away to a new home. Dad went into high gear. Those were not days for hiring contractors to do the work. There was no money for that. What he did not know to do, he learned or got help with. He was an all-rounder, trying his hand at plumbing, masonry, electrical, but woodworking was his real strength. Plumbing in those days, by the way, was not sticking plastic pipes together with glue. It was galvanized pipe you had to cut with a hacksaw, and then you had a tripod and a ratchet you had to thread it, and it was a lot of work. And he used to do all that, all the farm work, all the plumbing around our farm was done by him. The country home was born. We got old tanks and THs from the sugar factory. All the guttering ran them to a big concrete catchment tank that was already on site. Did I mention that Dad liked keeping tropical fish? Because he had done so in marine gardens. No, to keep the mosquitoes from breeding in the rain catchment tanks. Tropical fish were deployed in all of them. If the government water went off, which it did a lot up there at that time, because that house was like on a lonely road by itself, Dad had a pump for pumping the tank water to the house. Well, from two different ones. So every now and then you might get a guppy or a red hillary coming out. We were raising tilapia back then when no one would even consider eating them. Us children would hook buckets of them only to throw them back in again. Punishment for me in the early days of the farm was not getting licks, but being given multiples of pan carts, depending on how bad it was, to go and pick up rocks from the field where the cows grazed and dump them. So, you know, that was a lot of pan carts of rocks. The yard of our property at Selman's had some dilapidated outbuildings which would have been stables or pens, and they were painstakingly restored and improved by you-know-who. This became the milking parlor to the front and some stables to the back. Now we were getting horses or ponies from my equestrian sisters. Dad used to sit on a wooden stool, which of course he had made, and milk the cows by hand. We used the milk for ourselves, shared it with the gardener or helper, eventually started selling it to neighbors or whoever was interested. We made homemade butter. We had a goat ice cream. I still remember going with Dad to St. Philip to buy his first milking machine. It milked 2 cows at a time. It was on wheels, you had to push it. I think that not only was it starting to take too long to get through the milking, which had to be done twice every day, but maybe he was running out of old shirts. Some of the cows used to put their heads around and lick his back lovingly as he milked them. Have you ever been licked by a cow? Is like sandpaper, so they used to wear holes in his shirts, so he would have to keep changing his shirts all the time. The dairy grew. He got a bigger, fixed machine that could now milk 6 at a time. The land we rented wasn't getting any bigger, and the neighboring plantations wouldn't rent Dad any more land, and he couldn't afford to buy it anyway. So it was split. Split the fields with fencing and tried to rotate those 3 spaces. Still not enough grass for those cultures. So in crop time, we collected cane tops in the nearby cut cane fields and pulled them in a cart to the yard or fields for the cows. Outside of crop, we had a gardener who was a grass cutting machine with a sickle. He was powered by ESA Fields White Rum. I am not sponsored by them, by the way. I am not receiving any royalties. Yeah. Sorry, distracting. And then we had to get an old tractor and a grass cutter on the back to cut the amounts of grass we needed to keep up. This would all be cut on rab land between the nearby plantations. Sour grass, guinea grass, elephant grass, you name it, we cut it. It got loaded into horse box by us with pitchforks and came home behind the tractor. Then Dad, he found out he could get the spent grain from the brewery at the Wildy, at Wildy Banks, of course. They're not sponsoring me either. He made friends with the brewmasters, and they would call him when there was a batch of beer brewing. That could be any time of the day or night. But Dad could only go at night, as by now Port was expanding and getting much more busy, and he worked 5 days a week running that. So often he would be driving his old tractor and trailer down to the brewery in the middle of the night to get spent grain. Mm-hmm. In rain. Mm-hmm. I felt very, very guilty coming home at 4 o'clock in the morning on my motorbike and passing him in Salters. I'm now coming home from partying. He's now going for banks. Next day, the trailer needed to get shoveled into 55-gallon drums to be hand-carted to where the cows were to spread it out in troughs. That was a lot of shoveling. Mm-hmm. Yes, he built the troughs too. He worked 7 days a week, every day of the year, up at 4:30 every morning, a cup of tea, milk, feed, and be a vet to a garrison of cows, come up to the house, bathe, breakfast, and off to drop Charmin and I to school on the way to work, and do it all over again in the evening. So when I hear people say, when I ask them, how are you doing? They say, I'm tired. I think of Dad. Dad developed his herd by choosing the animals wisely. He bought cows from people on the island, sometimes just to help them out. But we used artificial insemination to improve the gene pool of our animals. Holsteins from the US and Canada for volume, and Jersey and Guernsey for the quality or high butterfat content. Mr. CEO would know about that. This was the best combination to get the best price of milk from the PhD. Farmers from all over the island used to come by to see what Dad did, and he was always willing to share and to learn from all of them. There's that respect thing again. We met so many tourists that were farmers on holiday with their families in Barbados and sought us out just out of interest in seeing how we did it here, from Canada, the US, England, and Wales. In 2 months' time, as a matter of fact, I will be reuniting with a family whose farm I worked on in Wales in 1978. They will be coming here on holiday. We met them at Selman's in St. Thomas when they came here as children with their father, their farmer parents on holiday. So there is a lesson for those who speak of niche marketing, BTMI. Not letting go of his interest in sailing, he hankered for his own sailboat. Uncle Sonny won't give him a piece of tall off of that boat, boy. Just kidding. And after years of hard work and saving up some of his milk money, he bought a 27-foot sailboat and had it shipped over from the UK. The photo that you may have seen rotating of him, well, you just see him on a yacht by himself, unless the girls were all hiding down inside. Probably not. Was him just after the boat had been launched directly from the ship into the water in the port. He sailed it, fished it, went down the Grenadines as far as Grenada and back on it. It was called Pinta, as in pint of milk, and not named after the Christopher Columbus vessel Pinta. He went on to own several more boats in his life: J-Star, Windsong, Peaches, One Love, Mandy. Many miles were sailed and many fish hooked aboard these yachts. He had gotten to the stage that now he had a crew to help run the dairy, so he did not have to be there every evening. We would often meet up at the yacht club, row to the boat, and sail off the mooring to the fishing banks. We almost never just went sailing, we fished under sail. If we caught one, we would feather the sails to slow down the boat and land it without using the engine. We would sail back up to the mooring too, so his engines got very little work. This first sailboat and the memories of our times together as a family were an inspiration for me getting into the charter business. Despite Dad being a strict and hard taskmaster, he surprised me from young, as early as 7, by letting me row myself all around Carlisle Bay alone in my dinghy. Nowadays, people wouldn't want to let their child go out of sight. At around 4, maybe one, that was a, maybe you had a reason for that. At around 14, he let me sail his new boat as a skipper without supervision. I did my first paying charters with it at age 15. He used to let us ride his and then our own motorcycles in our early teens as well. I was always amazed that he trusted me and us so easily. I could understand Charmaine because she was Captain Sensible.
Not me. I stuck with the horses.
The horses, right. Mind you, when I got my first scramble at 14, it came with a written contract between he and I. Agreements to the effect, must wear a helmet and suitable footwear. No riding on main roads, off-road only. Homework to be finished first. Acceptable grades to be maintained at school, etc., etc. The man was not easy. Dad's Merchant Navy training permeated his very existence. Everything he owned, everything he did, was done to perfection and completion. And we had to do the same. Do not make the mistake of leaving dirty dishes in the sink. Wash them, dry them, and put them away. No leaving them to dry in the drainer. From early in life, we use water like we were on a ship. Never leave a tap running when taking a shower. Wet your body, turn off the water, soap up, wash off, and then wash off. Manners were compulsory. Greet people by looking them in the eye, shaking their hands firmly. Never arrive or leave at anyone's house without speaking to all the grown-ups and saying goodbye and thank you before leaving. Shoes had to be polished every day. Clothes neat and tidy. Dad tucked in his shirt and his shorts and wore a belt almost to the end. Such a neat man. Always clean and tidy. Meal times were lost. For me, make sure my face and hands were washed, clean shirt on, hair brushed or combed. I had hair then, all right? Some of them might remember. Make sure elbows were tucked in. Chew with your mouth closed. No talking when you're chewing. Do not get up without finishing everything on your plate.
Yeah, bad news for me.
Yeah. Fine for me, but Misha and Sharms were not so partial for veg, especially overcooked veg in those days, and were not partial to deportment at the table, so there was pushback regularly. I just wanted to eat and move on. Some people had to spend a lot of time sitting at that table. We were not allowed to watch TV during the week. Listen to the radio when you're doing homework. Dad was stern but fair. Many of his port workers and colleagues echoed this to me later in life. Example, I got 3 good lashes after coming home from a fete, a dance in those days, because he told me not to smoke at the party. My mum was away. She used to usually share out the hard discipline. He dropped me off at the party and came back for me. I drank and smoked and rolled down the window as soon as I got back in the car, hoping he wouldn't smell it. He said, "You've been smoking. I told you not to smoke." Lashes and straight to bed when I got home. But he never mentioned the drinks. That was all about me, us having an agreement, and I broke it, see? So he was teaching me that. You do not break your agreements. Years later, after Dad was given an ultimatum by Mum, dairy or the port, he chose the port. I was away at the time. It must have been very difficult for him to sell off all that equipment and the cows, which he loved them. I think Misha had mentioned they all had names and they knew them, so those cows were treated like family. The physical and mental stress of them both having to manage, I believe, what had been perhaps the third largest dairy on the island, was taking its toll. The kids were grown up and away, so it was time to slow down. Dad's time at the port and shipping spanned almost 34 years, and he came with it from those days before it existed, with the help of many devoted and not so devoted teams, to bring it to the era of containerization, transshipment, etc., and from being managed by a private company to being a state-run corporation. This, of course, mm-hmm. met political interference and board members that change with the changes in government, so a new type of navigation became necessary. Regardless, Dad performed his duties with integrity and consistency.
Yes.
He worked under Prime Ministers Barrow, Tom Adams, Sandy Ford, and Arthur. After every election, the board would change and the policies, etc. So it was not an easy task to maneuver that time, but let's just say he did his best. And he always put Barbados's interests at heart and first. So I remember him telling me on the other side of the negotiating table, said he sat many times opposite Frank Walcott, who became Sir Frank Walcott, and he spoke of him with great respect. He said he was a very tough negotiator, but a gentleman and a fair man. Same for Sir Roy Trotman. I believe that they held Dad in the same esteem. Dad worked with some bright young men and ladies at the port, and some of them are still there now on the management team, and they still always ask for him and had great respect for him. After retirement, Dad spent a lot of time helping me with my business by captaining power and sailing boats, running kayak and snorkel tours, and he inspired many young people who work with us. He was fond of them all, and they love working with him. He and I spent many hours at sea over the years delivering boats, whether on my own or other people's. He was my mate and my buddy of choice until he just couldn't manage it anymore. Excellent navigator. He had most amazing eyesight, long distance eyesight, and of course, most dependable and reliable without equal. Aisha, you might be wondering where this Daddy Dan came from. But it came from this part of his life here, because all the young, at that time in Barbados, there was this thing, you know, they were calling you Dan Gorgons and Super Dans and Big and the Chief Dans, whoever Dans, and the crew, well, they named him Daddy Dan. That was his respectful name from them. So that kind of stuck. So there's a lot more I can share, but I think I've gone on enough. I think, anybody sleeping?
Oh my, we're not.
But thank you again. And he's touched each of your lives in some way, and he's left a mark on Barbados and further afield. He lives on in our hearts, and to my children, nieces, and nephews, I would say, follow his example, and you can never go wrong. Big up the Daddy Dan. He left me with a few sayings. They're not original sayings, but they are things that I hold dear to my heart. So I'd just like to read them off here quickly and explain them shortly for whoever might not quite understand. The same dog that brings a bone will carry one. He used to tell me that. Well, you think you know what that means. Somebody tell you a story, they might carry back another one. The only thing constant in life is change. So that helped me a lot in my life, because there were a lot of big changes in my life, and it made me, between him and another mentor, Mr. Williams over here, who always told me there's a right way, a wrong way, and a profitable way to do something. Well, the Daddy Dan would do it the right way. That's why he didn't end up rich or made a lot of money. He did all right, but he always did it the right way. I used to say, Dad, why do you have to always do it? You always pick the hardest way to do this thing. But it was the right way. Anyhow, quickly on, let me finish up. Eye of the master fattens the beast. Well, whether you're a farmer, if you're a farmer, you know what that means right away. Any other business person, if you don't keep an eye on your business, it will go as fast as it comes. For sailors here, macro sails, scales and mare's tails make lofty ships carry low sails. Mm-hmm. I'll read that again. Macro scales and mare's tails make lofty ships carry low sails. So those are types of clothes, right? When you see those high-level clothes that look like scales and wisps, like mare's tails, that's when the tall ships have to lower down their sails and only carry them reef down the sails, in other words. When you make your bed, you must lay down in it. I think that's obvious. And this one helps me almost every week, especially in tourists in rainy season, mm-hmm. when the tourists are calling to say, you guys sailing today? AccuWeather says, And I used to say, I tell the girls rain. What daddy done. Used to tell me, rain before 7, fine by 11. So there we are. So he always used to say to me that when this time came, he would just like to sail out to sea. So fair winds and following seas.
My father and friend.
Thank you all.
Okay. Welcome, everyone. Okay. Welcome, everyone. I'm Charmaine, the youngest daughter of Peter, Dad, Daddy Dan, Spider-Man. I've been married to Barry for almost 40 years, and we have two very handsome sons, Thomas and Nicholas. Please stand. No, you don't really have to. And all of my guys are here with us today. We live in Montego Bay, Jamaica. Seeing so many people gathered here today to pay their last respects and to say goodbye to our dad shows just how loved he was and how much he will be missed. Okay, I'm good. Thank you all for coming to share in this celebration of Dad's life. It means the world to us. I don't know if I'm going to read this one. Okay, the title Father is to me. Read it for
the
me.
The noblest title that a man can hold. It's way more than a biological role. A father is the patriarch of a family. He's a leader, role model, provider, teacher, hero, and best friend. Dad was all of those things. He wore all of those hats proudly, and he was a God-fearing sea captain. Arr.
Okay, let me try again. We all know that the first child is always, as they say, the most precious. Mish, that's you. And the second child, if it's the first son, then that supersedes the first child. Sorry, that's Nick. And by the time the third child comes along, it's all good. Time is very limited now, and the others were fine. This one will be good too. Well, that was not the case for me, because in my mind, I was always the favorite. I got the baby of the family title. Sorry, Nisha and Nick. Needless to say, being the third in line to say a few words means that I have little left that's not already been told. So I will share just a few quick memories that always brought a warm feeling to my heart. Okay. We moved to our first country home in 1965, the one that Nick has described as a shell in his story, Selman's in St. Thomas. Within a few weeks, we were greeted by our new neighbors, the Armstrongs and Michael Eastwood from Fisher Pond, the Coxes from Applewaite's, the Ward family from Greenacres, Vernon and Brendan Nichols from Applewaite's, the Marshalls from Clifton, just to mention a few. Neighbors in those days all helped each other in every way possible. Dad and Mum shared eggs, milk, vegetables, and our neighbors brought yams, sweet potatoes, breadfruit, edos, and whatever crops they had. Once I remember a huge cow, heavy in calf, called Sunjet, who had flown in on a Bee Wee flight that evening, arrived, and she...
We lost her luggage.
She was terrified, and she escaped, and she disappeared. We couldn't find her. Anyway, she was in a nearby gully. But I remember that everyone, all of our neighbors, came to help Dad with his search and rescue. And they were out all night combing the nearby fields until she was safely returned the next morning. Other times, when it was cane harvest season, our family would help with the firefighting because we were surrounded by, cane fields. So we would help on the trailers in the surrounding fields. Kids had to stand back, but Dad and all the farm hands would lend a hand. Full moon nights would often find us riding in a horse and buggy carts. I don't know how many people have ever done that, but Uncle John and Auntie Bev used to arrange it. We would drive through the connecting roads between our homes, children wrapped up in blankets, picnic baskets packed, and adults having cocktails and enjoying the glorious moonlight. These memories are priceless. Sometimes I close my eyes and go right back there. Dad had many hobbies. He never did anything by halves, as you have heard. All of his hobbies required full-on dedication, time, patience, perseverance, and hard work. He led by example, and we all followed. When he decided to get a cow, so that we could all drink nutritious milk, that's how it started. We all loved the fresh milk, and so he decided to breed that cow. Well, what happens then? Then the milk dries up, right? So Dad had to buy another cow to supply the necessary. This happened several times. And so over the space of 3 years, we had a dairy of 70 head of cattle. Some hobby, right? Dad's real job was general manager at the Barbados Port Authority, a position that he, as you've heard and you know, all of you, was dedicated to. Anyway, cows, as you know, have to be milked twice a day, 7 days a week, but Dad loved this hobby so much, and he loved his cows so much that they all had individual names, and they came when they were called. So twice a day, Dad and Mum, with the help of a few farm workers, would call each cow by name. The cow would moo, file into the milking station, step up onto the platform, and that was prepared for her. The cows were fed mash, which is like slushy cow food in a bucket, as opposed to bangers and mash. So they would be happy and relaxed and let their milk down. Anyway, we would all help with the brainstorming of the christening of the cows. So each time a new calf or cow was purchased, we would all convene. We had Daisy, Brownie, Dawn, Chocolate. Wishful thinking. Her milk was not chocolate, sadly. We had Beauty, Clarice, Lorna, Sunjet, Jean and Dinah, Rosita and Clementina. Please don't take this personally if I'm calling your name. There's no offense meant, but you get the idea now, right? I used to love to hug the cows, and farm life certainly fostered our love for all animals, cows, horses, dogs especially, and many others too. Farm life came with many benefits, of course. So we can all milk a cow, ride a horse, ride a motorbike, drive a tractor, muck out a stable, clean a horse's hoof, catch a chicken, and roast a breadfruit on an open fire outside, just to mention a few. We've all rescued a dog or two, helped with whelping puppies and bathed and groomed countless cows, horses, and dogs. We've passed this love on to our children, who have all developed the same love for animals and rescued dogs themselves. Some of my personal favorite times were spent sailing with Dad. Come on, Ish. Yeah. Sunday sails
were best, as we did not have to hurry from Carlisle Bay to North Point almost. Dad would trim the sails and have us sit on the side with our legs hanging over to provide ballast. We could see the keel peeping and would all be filled with adrenaline. Sometimes we would pull into Six Men's Bay and other times Sandy Lane Bay, depending on how hungry we were and how calm the sea was. We often cooked up a rice pilau with chicken, one of Dad's favourite boat meals. We scoffed the lot and washed it all down with an ice cold Coke, the single one allotted to us for the week. What a treat. Dad would have a few banks bare and then take a nap and read the paper while we were free to swim ashore, snorkel on the shallow reefs, or just daydream as we lay on the deck and watched the clouds go past. can you manage?
Yes, thank you, Dad, for these carefree times and for all the love you shared. We will cherish these memories for all time. God bless you all. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Michelle, Nick, and Charmaine, for allowing us a glimpse into the life of this amazing man, Peter Parker. On behalf of Harvest Network, Angels of Mercy, and also The Living Room, I take this opportunity to extend our deepest sympathy to all of your families during this time of your loss. I know a father has a special relationship with daughters, but you were very close to your dad, Nick. And the way that you and your wife, Nicole, looked after your parents in their latter years is commendable. The Bible says, honor your father and mother that you may live a long life. It's the first command of promise. So God's blessing will continue to rest upon your life because of the way that you have looked after your parents. Thank you. Thank you. I know that we have been sitting, for some of you, a long time. It would seem as though our attention spans are getting shorter. But I'm going to ask you, please, if you would give me your undivided attention for just a few moments more, because what I have to share is of the utmost importance. I will not keep you long. For those of you who have heard me speak before, you know that I tend to be short. As we heard about Peter Parker, this amazing individual with a tremendous work ethic, and what he has instilled and what we see in his children, his grandchildren, and probably we will see in his great-grandchildren, is amazing. A life to be emulated. And yet, there was a point in time when Peter Parker heard the gospel and realized he had a problem. Before we talk about Peter's problem, we have to ask, what is the gospel? The gospel, basically, in a nutshell, is that Jesus died for our sins according to the scriptures. That he was buried and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, full stop. That is the good news. But notice it says, it didn't just say that Jesus died according to the scriptures. He died for our sins according to the scriptures. Jeremiah chapter 17 verse 9 says, the human heart is the most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who can really know how bad it is? Certainly we don't know what we are capable of, but the scriptures tell us what we are capable of. It tells us that we are deceitful, and that we are desperately wicked. That is why we do some of the things that we don't even want to do. We can't help ourselves sometimes. It is interesting that a father would discipline a child for lying and then turn around and lie. A lot of people do things when nobody is looking because they know what they're doing is wrong. You ask anyone, is stealing wrong? They will tell you yes, but they will still steal. Is committing adultery wrong? Of course it is, and they will frown and look down, but sometimes they're involved in committing adultery. Is lying wrong? Yes, but we lie. The heart of man is deceitful and desperately wicked. This is our problem. It applies to all of us. We didn't invent this. It was passed down to us by our forefathers. We inherited it. We inherited what we call this Adamic nature. You know what I'm talking about is true. Because there are some things that you don't want to do, but you end up doing, and you don't know why. It is because we have a problem. Really, it is God's problem. We can't fix it. It is too big for us to fix. So God has to find a solution, and He did. He found a solution. That is why Jesus came in the form of a man, took upon Himself human form that we could identify with Him, He with us. And the Word of God says that He took the sin of the world upon Himself. What that means, I really don't know. But I believe that if we could look into the eyes of Jesus when He hung on that cross for us, and we could see the horror in His face, in His eyes, when He said, my God, why have You forsaken Me? I believe we will get a glimpse of what He went through. We think of the beatings. We think of how His back was lacerated. We think of all the humiliation that He experienced. That was, I think, the easier part. The harder part was being separated from His Father and what He experienced at that point in time. He came, He took our punishment that we could address this problem that we have of being rotten at the core. God wants us to be changed from the inside out. And that's what the Bible talks about, being born again. You see, no one will be separated from God eternally because of their sin. We will be separated from God because we have not accepted the only way that God has prescribed for us to deal with our sinful nature. Three times Jesus prayed, Father, if it is possible that this cup can be removed from me, let it be so. In other words, Father, if there is some other way for us to accomplish what we want to accomplish on behalf of the human race, let's find it. Three times He prayed that. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. If there is another way for us to deal with the problem of our deceitful hearts, then I submit to you that Jesus died in vain. But yet Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. So Peter, realizing that he had this problem, acknowledged it and trusted God for His provision in the person of Jesus to atone for his sin. To give him, you see, the Bible never speaks about repairing our hearts. The Bible talks about having a new heart, that God will take this stony, deceitful, resentful heart and give us a new heart. That's what the new birth is all about, being born again. Now, I did not know Peter that well. I knew your mom very well. But based on what you're saying, there came that point when Peter accepted Jesus as his only means of salvation. That is who he trusted in, not Jesus and something else. You know, we have this strange notion that by going to church on a Sunday, that's going to help us. As though that is, you know, that we are doing our service for God and we are racking up points. It is by trusting in Jesus alone, not by trusting in Jesus and going to church, not by trusting in Jesus and giving to the poor, not by trusting in Jesus and doing something else, but trusting that what he did on the cross was enough to atone for my sin. If we could stand here this evening and be honest about what our lives are really like, we would realize that we're all in the same boat. We're all in need of a Savior. The only difference is that some of us have trusted in Jesus, and by trusting in him, when we get a glimpse of who Jesus is, when we see that, when we come to understand who he really is, it is impossible for us to have a glimpse and our hearts not be captivated. There is enough proof, there is enough evidence there for us to come and to taste and to see that God is real, that Jesus is alive. He is a man with a body in heaven at this time, like how Peter has a new body. He is not dead, but he is alive. He is maybe more alive now than he was before. I am not concerned about him. I am concerned about those of us who are in this building this afternoon that have never really surrendered to Jesus. The God that has revealed himself to me, the God that I have been following, the God that I am still getting to know for 46 years is a God who is persistent in his love towards us. He comes after us. He knocks. He comes knocking at our heart's door. And I would say to you this afternoon, if you feel a little uncomfortable, that is okay. It is God trying to get your attention. God called a man, Moses, many, many years ago. You know the story. Moses was tending, not cows, but sheep. He saw a bush burning, but that was not consumed. And Moses turned aside to see what this was. I am asking you, I am begging you, if you feel God is knocking at your door, turn aside. Begin to investigate. God will reveal himself to you, that you can know, like how Peter knew, that God is alive, that Jesus is who he said he is, and that he is coming again. I beg you, I plead with you, I implore you to listen to the voice of God. If he is calling, please respond. The Bible also says God in his mercy will continue to reach out to us. But it also says the Spirit of God will not always strive with man. If God is speaking, I want to encourage you to respond. Let's pray. Father, thank you that you've given us your Holy Spirit to lead us, to guide us into all truth. And I pray, Father, that if there is anyone here that have never fully surrendered to you, I pray, Father, that you would continue to draw them, woo them unto yourself. And I pray in your mercy that you would reveal yourself to them, even as you have revealed yourself to so many in this place that are walking with you. I pray, Lord, that they would acknowledge their need of you, that we are in desperate need of you, and that by opening their lives to you and allowing you, Lord, to change and to give them a new heart, that they will experience life, that they would know what it is to pass from death unto life, and that they will have this great assurance that to be absent from this body is to be present with you. Thank you again for comforting Phil and Michelle, Nick and Nicole, Barry and Charmaine and their families. For us here who knew Peter and maybe grieving, we pray, Lord, that you would give us all that assurance that he is in a good place, he is with you. And I pray in your grace and your mercy that you will continue to speak to us. In your Son's name I pray. Amen. Well, it's getting late, and we're going to bring this celebration of the life of Peter Parker to an end. He is not going to be cremated today. It will be a private cremation at another time where the family will gather together. But at this time, I'm going to ask if we stand as we would leave. I'm going to ask if family goes first. The casket will be placed in the hearse and it will be taken away until another time. Sure. In your program, you would have seen an envelope where you can make a donation to the Barbados Sailing Association or the Barbados RSPCA. If you have a pen and you would like to make a donation, just put a little tick or some indication as to which of the two organizations you would like your donation to be given to, and we will receive those envelopes. Thank you.